So many of you may look at this impressive looking structure and say to yourself, self, I wonder what's going on underneath that black shroud. Well, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, friends and neighbors, we're going to take you on a tour of what is underneath that black shroud.
Christmas comes, but not yet. Before we celebrate, let us wait, taking time to remember who is coming. Time to prepare our lives, time to look outwards in love. Christmas waits to come. Gently count the days. Time to wait and walk with God. Time to fill with praise. Welcome, St. Paul's United Church of Christ. Whether you are gathering in person here in this sanctuary or joining us virtually, we are ready to celebrate this first Sunday of Advent with the Festival of the Greens. Before the formal introduction, I just have a few general comments about the service that I would like to share with you. First of all, if you have your cell phones, your smartphones, check in. Let folks know where you are, that you are at St. Paul's this morning and that you are joining in this celebration. Silence your phones out of courtesy for others. And also a reminder that this is a service that has a lot of movement and a lot of singing. There are multiple readers that will be traveling back and forth to the lectern. They have a copy of the complete service. Their readings will not be announced by me, so they will pop in and out of the lectern as the order of the service shows us. And also, not all of the songs will be announced. A lot of them throughout the service. Preston will give us a brief introduction to the carol, and then we will join in singing. Not all of the verses are sung to the carols that appear in your service. The projection screen will follow the order of the service as you have in your printed bulletin. So please, you can follow it along on the screen, same with the songs, or you're also welcome to use the hymnals. Another thing that I really like to share is that we are a family decorating our church home this morning for this holy season. Just like in our personal homes, everything may not go perfectly, but it is the joy of being together as God's children and sharing in this moment, being together to prepare this sacred space for the coming of our Lord and Savior. The cycle around which our worship revolves is the church year. And today we begin a new season of the church year, the season of Advent. During the Advent season, we prepare for the one who has come, whom we expect to come, and who will come again. In the Advent season, we recall God's entering history as one of us, in his Son, Jesus Christ. We prepare our hearts so that God will find room and expression in our lives. As we proceed through the Advent season, we pray for the day when every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. During Advent, we look toward Christmas, the fulfillment of God's love for all people. Through many generations, we have had reminders of Jesus' birth in the beautiful symbols of music, customs, and traditions, so that we will not forget what our God has done. In the Festival of the Greens, we share with Christians through the ages the memory and anticipation of Christ's coming. We festively decorate our church with the symbols of life, joy, and hope. Jewish children at the Passover celebration ask, "Why do we do this? What does this mean?" The story of the angel of death passing over the homes of the Hebrews is retold so that the generations will not forget that mighty act of God. Christian children will ask, "Why do we do this? What does this mean?" We tell our story again and then proclaim, "God is with us. Jesus Christ is born." Let us pray together our prayer of invocation. God of manger and star, let us enter your story once again and find ourselves kneeling with the shepherds, singing with the angels, and worshiping with the Magi. Touch our hearts with the wonder of birth and the depths of your love. Speak to us in word and song, and lift us to the realms of glory. Amen. Those that are gathered in person, please stand as you are able for the singing of our opening hymn, O Come, Emmanuel.
Which cover our altar, our pulpit, and lectern, are something like drapes or curtains in a home. With the changing colors of the church year, they attract attention, add variety, and point to the significance of the season or festival being celebrated. The traditional color of Advent is purple, a color that signifies the sacred and spiritual fulfillment. Some traditions use blue, which represent anticipation and promise.
We hear these words from Isaiah 60, verses 2 to 3. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. The lighting of candles has been a part of religious worship for centuries. The Hebrews burned candles for 8 days as part of their feast of lights. Light has been used by many religious groups to symbolize truth, while the darkness of night has been the universal symbol for evil. Since Jesus was called the light of the world in the New Testament, the lighting of candles has become an important part of our Christian worship. Some early Christian leaders stated that the wax of altar candles represented the body of Christ, while the wick symbolized his soul, and the flame portrayed his divine nature. Candles made from pure beeswax were used to signify Mary, since this wax comes from virgin bees. This has resulted in the practice of some churches to burn only beeswax candles upon the altar or communion table. When Joseph and Mary presented Jesus in the temple, Simeon referred to the Christ child as a light to lighten the Gentiles. From this statement, church leaders have used candles to symbolize the light of Christ shining throughout a broken world. The two altar candles symbolize Jesus. One candle reminds us of the human life of Jesus, the example he gave, the wholeness of his life, words, and deeds. The other candle reminds us of Jesus' divinity, that Jesus is God, the second person of the Trinity. Jesus came from God, dwelt among human beings, and gave his life for the sins of the world. In this holy season of Advent, may we be reminded that our candles symbolize God, Emmanuel, God with us, whose transforming power heals the world of sin and evil, war and strife, stress and turmoil, suffering and despair. Jesus embodies hope and help for those held captive by oppression. His ministry guides us to personal peace and joy through the illumination of his message of the love of God. Please join me in the response. As these candles give their light for others to see, may we bear the light of Christ to others. Let us praise God that the light of Christ shines on in the darkness, which has never overcome.
Thank you. get a closer look at it, up close as we talk about it. Now, as you might be able to see, the Advent wreath is made up of a simple circle of evergreen branches. And the reason they use evergreen branches is because, as the name suggests, the branches are ever or always green. And the branches are bent into the shape of a circle. And if you think about a circle, it really has no beginning and no end. It just goes round and round and round. And the circle of evergreen branches reminds us of the promise of eternal life, which we have when we believe in Jesus. Eternal life, life that goes on and on and on forever. Now the Advent wreath also has candles on it. How many candles are on the Advent wreath? How many, Pam? That's right, there are 5 candles. And the reason there are candles on our Advent wreath is because they remind us that Jesus is the light of the world.
Thank you.
to our ancestors came true when Jesus was born. God's promise is kept each Sunday when we worship because Christ is in our midst. God will keep the promise to come again in glory. Isaiah chapter 60, verse 2 says, "See, darkness covers the earth, and thick darkness is over the peoples. But the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you." Would you please join me in the responsive litany? In this season of Advent, we long for God's presence.
Christ is our light and the source of our hope.
In this season of Advent, we search for God's truth.
Christ is our light and the source of our hope.
In this season of Advent, we seek God's guidance.
Christ is our light and the source of our hope.
In this season of Advent, we remember God's promise.
Christ is our light and the source of our hope.
We light this candle of hope to proclaim the coming of the light of God into the world. With the coming of this light, there is hope. Because of Christ, we not only have hope, but we believe that good is stronger than evil. God wants us to work for good in this world. Let us pray. O God, we thank you that Jesus brought hope into our world. By the good news of the Bible, you are still bringing hope to people. Help us to be ready to welcome Jesus Christ so that we may think good thoughts and do good deeds, and so that we may always be a people of hope in our world. Amen.
Evergreens have long been considered symbols of eternity, a sign of God's everlasting nature, and an indication that the faithful will experience eternal life in the communion with God in Jesus Christ. The Advent custom of decorating with evergreen branches comes to us from the peasants of the Middle Ages, who believed that the preparations should be made for the coming of Jesus. On the first Sunday of Advent, each family would gather evergreens and place them near the hearth in their home. We continue that tradition today as our greens are hung in our sanctuary, our church home. We now put our finishing touches on our balcony railings garland of greens.
It's okay to turn around and look up and see
The symbolic evergreens we use to decorate our sanctuary will remind us of God's abiding love in Jesus Christ and our eternal relationship with God.
Legends have helped us keep alive a lot of special Christmas plants and flowers. A favorite in the United States is the poinsettia, with its red star-shaped flower, known in Central America as flame leaf or flower of the holy night. It was brought here over 100 years ago by Dr. Joel Poinsett, our first ambassador to pick some flowering weeds along the roadside the moment she placed them before the Virgin statue. They turned into brilliant poinsettia blossoms in the poinsettia belt of California. Growers pot and ship these
Christmas plants to every state in the Union. While we do not offer these beautiful plants as gifts, to Mary we decorate our homes, altars, tables, and hearts with them in remembrance of loved ones, keeping alive the memory of joyous Christmas past.
And we come to the Christmas tree. Once again, we hear from the prophet Isaiah as he says, "For you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall burst into song, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come the cypress. Instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall be to the Lord for a memorial, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. The glory of Lebanon shall come to you, the cypress, the plane, and the pine, to beautify the place of my sanctuary, and I will glorify where my feet rest." As we prepare for the coming of Jesus, the light of the world, we light the Christmas tree. Today, the Christmas tree is the center of our festivities. Glittering with lights and ornaments, it is a part of the beauty and meaning of Christmas. The first use of the Christmas tree was in medieval German plays, held outdoors and portraying the creation of humankind. Later, ornaments were hung upon them, such as paper flowers and gilded nuts. In England, branches or even whole trees were forced into bloom indoors for Christmas. Martin Luther placed candles on a tree to represent the glorious heavens. We finish hanging our ornaments on our tree in anticipation of the celebration of our Savior's birth.
Marley, you want to come over? Do we have other children that want to come up front and help finish decorating our tree?
Thank you.
nativity scene. The Christmas decor would not be complete without the presence of the nativity scene. We remember the first Christmas night as Mary and Joseph took shelter in a stable, using a manger or a feeding trough filled with straw for a crib. Mary lay down her newborn baby to sleep. Cattle, donkeys, and other livestock didn't seem to mind the invasion of their home by the weary travelers. As the angels proclaimed the news of the birth to shepherds out in the field, excitement filled the air. Months later, wise men from the east followed a star to Bethlehem in search of the baby, the king. With them, they brought valuable gifts, which they presented to the child as they worshipped him. By the time the wise men found Jesus, he and his family had probably found more suitable housing than the stable. Nevertheless, we associate the wise men with the first Christmas night and often complete the nativity scene with the Magi and their camels.
As you look at the decorations here and those you will have in your home during the next few weeks, use them to remind yourself of the wonderful gift God gave us, the sacrifice he made of his only son, and the unsurpassable love he demonstrated for us. The greatest gift of Christmas is the gift of God in Christ Jesus. All that we do at this holy season points to that expression of holy love. Christ came as a babe in Bethlehem, God's gift at Christmas. As Christians, we seek to pass on our heritage to our children and to those who, by faith in Christ, become part of the family of God. It is through the work of the Holy Spirit in your life and mine that the gift goes on.
Thank you.
At this time of year, we see many of our church decorations, not only in our homes, but we see the decorations also appear in storefronts, in restaurants, on front yards, porches, in one room or many rooms, many places trimmed in evergreens and adorned and glittering with lights, Christmas trees, poinsettias, nativity scenes. I so hope that you enjoyed hearing and learning more about the meaning and significance of many of the decorations that we display at Christmas. I also hope that in our season of Advent at St. Paul's, that you will enjoy hearing, sharing, and talking about our theme of the season, the wonder of Christmas, as we consider the wonder of a name, the wonder of a promise, the wonder of a manger. You and I know that young children, even toddlers, they are so much better to opening themselves to the wonder of the Christmas season. There is something magical about watching children experience such wonder at Christmas. Their little mouths as they drop open in awe and amazement when they're seeing their Christmas tree lit for the first time. And if they're only 2 years old, you get that look of awe every morning. Every morning throughout the season. Folks, it seems that as we grow up and enter our adult years, that we seem to lose our sense of wonder. Elizabeth Anderson, in her article, The Wisdom in Wonder, Children at Christmas Time, says, as residents of the information age, we often feel utterly bereft of wonder, deprived of wonder, without wonder. We are left wanting, in other words. Why wonder when you can Google it? But wondrous things surround us, which cannot fit into dictionary or Wikipedia entries, but can fill our souls with awe if we but let them. With all the demands and distractions of the season, we often wish we could just get back some of that wonder for ourselves. In God or Nothing, Robert Cardinal Sarah comments, children are marvelous. They sense the heart of God and the mysteries of his love that meet us even in our serious sins and petty weaknesses. They rejoice easily for the simple reason that children are more easily ready and willing to wonder than most grown-ups. But maybe this is the year, St. Paul's United Church of Christ, for you and for me and for our families. Maybe this will be the year that we, God's children of all ages, will seek the gift of wonder and awe. The gift to appreciate God's glories and wonders on display at every moment and everything we see and everything we encounter. Maybe this will be the year that we, God's children of all ages, will rediscover the true wonder of Christmas, which is all wrapped up in God's radical love. Let us join our voices together as we sing, I wonder as I wander.
Thank you.
we continue to wonder about this time that is before us, this season of waiting and anticipation for the celebration of the birth of our Savior, we are excited that we have one more 150 Fund testimonial that is a part of this service this morning. Donna, I invite you to come to the lectern and share with us your story.
Okay, I'm going to start at the beginning of my faith journey. I grew up attending the Lansdale Methodist Church, which was near my home growing up. I went to Sunday school, sang in the junior choir, was confirmed, and I was active in the youth group there. Then I went to college. I felt that I was certainly a Christian and had learned what I needed to know to carry me through my life. Then during college, Scott came with me to our family church at that time, which had changed because we had moved, and it was in Bluebell. In fact, for a time, we led the youth group there in that small church, bringing us home from college on weekends and for special events. After we were married, we continued to attend Bethel Hill Methodist Church in Bluebell. We were involved in the Sunday school program and continued to be involved in the youth group. Then we built our house in Sellersville, had our daughters, and we stopped going to church for a period of time. Again, feeling secure in our faith and not really having the need to attend church weekly. When Lauren and Lindsay were of the age where we thought they could benefit from Sunday school, we looked for a church nearby that we could start to attend. We wanted to build that firm foundation in Christianity that we had from a young age. Scott's friends from childhood, Rick and Jay, were already here with their families, which definitely influenced our choice. But from the moment we walked into St. Paul's, we knew we had found our church. We were greeted by Luther Smith, and Pastor George, Carolyn, and Johanna Fine embraced us and our daughters. God knew what he was doing. Soon after we joined here, my mother was diagnosed with ovarian cancer, taking us on a journey like no other I had experienced or had to this day. As we were living through that awful diagnosis, Scott's mom was diagnosed with colon cancer. During those years of chaos, sadness, and loss, Pastor George was there for us. St. Paul's was there for us. Lauren and Lindsay learned about death at very young ages, losing one grandmother at the ages of 5 and 7, and the other grandmother at the ages of 10 and 12. But they also learned about the awesome promise that life does not end for Christians, that God promises a beautiful heaven for life everlasting. I was able to function as a mother, wife, brownie leader, summer camp director, and teacher, along with the grace of God and his continual support and guidance. Our family's faith was strengthened through those tragedies. Prayer became a very large part of my life and continues to be. Going forward, Pastor George confirmed both of the girls and also married them, Lauren and Mike right here in the sanctuary, and then Lindsay and Jeffrey after George's retirement on a beach in Avalon. I've been spending a lot of time here the last month or so, up and down that side hill, getting ready for the pot pie dinner and taking care of the Rampax pantry, pretty much daily, watching the progress of the tower repairs. Those big stones remind me of the foundation we came here hoping to build for our daughters. The tower itself reminds me of my own faith journey, as I have learned to follow God's lead whenever he seeks to move me, whether it be being a member of consistory, helping with the mother-daughter decorations for a banquet, teaching Sunday school, starting a clown ministry, organizing a trip across the country to an international faith event, to mentor a confirmand, or 5 or 6, to help with a church dinner, to start a food pantry to provide weekend food for hungry children. My journey here has led me in many directions, all guided from above, with his support, as well as the support from my church family. When I look at the stained glass windows, they remind me of you, the people of St. Paul's, your stories, and our shared experiences. And they also remind me of the Bible and the importance of the stories of the life of Jesus and his sacrifice for me. When I hear the bell ring every Sunday, I'm reminded of the music that I've been able to experience here and now be part of through my time here. As Neil, Preston, and Rick all mentioned in their testimonials, music is also a large part of my faith experience. I also get so much out of singing in the choir, ringing the bells, and just enjoying all the music that is so creatively incorporated into our services. The front door reminds me of the welcoming feeling I get every Sunday when I come to church. The door also stirs a little excitement as I wonder what God is going to have in store for me next. The porch light reminds me of the light that burns strongly inside of me thanks to my faith, my experiences, and the leadership and encouragement I've had here, starting with Pastor George, then Pastor Patty, Pastor John, and now from Pastor Trudy. As I've watched the guys carefully mixing and placing the new mortar between those big stones, I am so thankful that our tower is being repaired. Although our church attendance has fluctuated over the years of the busy life God has laid out for us, St. Paul's has always stood for that solid rock on which our faith is built. Hopefully this church will be here and grow to mean as much to our 6 grandchildren as it does to me, especially during this season of my life. We have been members here for 35 years, and I feel the connection to the building, the 150 years of St. Paul's history, and the church community. I really pray for that future for members of our family and yours.
Thank you so much, Donna. These past weeks of hearing these testimonials have just been, I think, one of our greatest blessings. Each testimonial has been very unique, very powerful, but definitely the common thread is that feeling of folks that when they walk through our doors of being part of a family and being loved and cared for and supported and nurtured in their faith. Praise be to God for every testimonial, and that we do continue on now in and beyond that 150-year history that we've been celebrating over this past year. In our community life, there are a few things that I do need to touch upon this morning. Holly Jacoby had reached out to me a few days ago asking for prayer for her cousin, Heather Madden. Heather has lupus and has been very sick. I'm sure there are others within our church family, your friends, your family, that we lift up in our prayers for healing, for strength, for courage, and we support each one and each other in this journey. I also want to lift up a great joy and celebrate with and congratulate again Preston Ziegenfuss. Preston was presented with his Eagle Scout Award yesterday afternoon during his Eagle Court of Honor ceremony. Congratulations again, Preston. Very, very much deserved. Very much deserved. I also do not want you to miss the signups. We have many. There are deadlines today to sign up for Christmas caroling, for the care packages for college students. I think, Nancy, they're put together on Tuesday of this week at 6:30 in Fretz Hall. Also, please see the sign up for the poinsettias. If you have any questions, if you have any money that you need to hand in, Lucille is the woman to see after worship today. Also, the proposed 2022 church budget in print form is available in the Narthex. Our congregational meeting will be held following worship in 2 weeks, December 12th. Next Sunday, second Sunday of Advent, December 5th, we will have a special prayer of dedication during our worship service for our Bethany Children's Home gifts. If you haven't brought those unwrapped gifts in yet, the list of needed items is in your newsletter from November, and there is a special basket for those to be placed in. And Brenda, I'm also going to include a special prayer and dedication of the fish gift cards that'll be going to the families in our community this time of Christmas. Anything to lift up about the tree at this time? Are you... Okay, so the Fish Christmas Family Tree is in the Narthex area, ready for those ornaments to go on, letting us know the items that are needed to be purchased. So please watch that. And also, don't lose sight of the fish food pantry items that are needed. I know there's some extra and some special items that get put on there for Thanksgiving. And then, of course, with Christmas coming, there's going to be some other extra items that are needed. I encourage you and invite you, as always, you are so generous, and to continue that generosity throughout this holy season of Advent and into Christmas. In the invitation to generosity, we hear these words: not by human hands will the kingdom of God be built, but by compassion and trust in God's presence in all things. We offer the work of our hands and the faith of our hearts as we make our morning offering.
Thank you.
Join me in our prayer of dedication and the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. God of hope, made known in Jesus, who became the Christ, receive our gifts that they may bless the work and witness of this place and these your people. We continue to pray in one voice, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Before we join our voices for the commissioning and the benediction, there is one announcement that I did not forget. I don't ever forget about food. Unless you absolutely have somewhere else to be at this time, please don't leave after our closing hymn. You may be seated during the playing of the postlude. There will be, I do believe, a video tour of the tower that we will enjoy from this space in the sanctuary. Then there will be brunch, a waffle bar that you do not want to miss, 150 fun displays where you can learn more about our building projects, and a special table, I do believe, Karen, with a display of Reverend George Schmidt's days here at St. Paul's. So again, unless you absolutely have somewhere else you need to be, please stay. Let us share in our commissioning and benediction. Joy is now in every place. The light of promise shines on every wall and window and door. So does that same light shine in each and every heart gathered here. Let us go into God's world to share that same light, the light of the one who comes. Amen. We join our voices in song as we sing our closing hymn, verses 1 and 2 only, of Thou Didst Leave Thy Throne.
this video just to embellish on the waffle bar. If you can't find, well, I'm just going to tell you what's there so you don't get confused and don't get halfway through and say, oh, I should have waited. There are 120 waffles, Eggos, so they'll know I'm fighting Lego my Eggo. We should all have plenty. There's, for those of you who are just plain, there's butter. And there's syrup that's being warmed, I hope. There are rainbow sprinkles. There is a warm mixed berries compote for the adventuresome. There's powdered sugar to shake on top of that. There are mini chocolate chips if you like that. There are mini M&Ms if you love those. Oh, and don't forget the whipped cream topping that can be sprayed on any of that stuff. There's chocolate syrup if you just like chocolate syrup. There's apple pie filling and there's cherry pie filling that hopefully they're warming as well. Oh, and then there's chicken. Yes, there's chicken to put on your waffle. And then we'll bring it up in a little bit, but there's ice cream as well. It's been sliced into little pieces that you can put on your second waffle or third waffle or whatever it happens to be for you. There's coffee, right, dear? There's coffee, there's orange juice, and there's chocolate milk. Hopefully you'll find something there that you like. Please don't leave or we'll have thousands and thousands of extra things left. And now for the tour of the tower. Look at this impressive looking structure and say to yourself, self, I wonder what's going on underneath that black shroud. Well, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, friends and neighbors, we're going to take you on a tour of what is underneath that black shroud. So here's a look up close and personal at the front door and some of the stonework going on around it. The joints are filled in a couple of steps sometimes. The deeper the joint, sometimes takes two steps to fill that joint. And some of these joints, see some brown colored mortar that will be covered with the light gray colored mortar that will be the finished product. So the brown mortar you see is just the first step in filling that deep joint. This special mortar mix is hand mixed in 5 gallon pails at a time and hand carried up the scaffolding and then applied by hand by these skilled masons. Difficult part of this journey will be the first 15 or 16 rungs of this ladder to get to the platform where we can take stairs to the very top. Stay tuned. All right, here goes nothing. Meticulous work going into every joint. had been covered by plastic. Protect it from the rain and to actually keep it warm because there are lights, if you can see, underneath the plastic to provide warmth. There's Preston to help cure the concrete. There's probably a roof leak or two that occurred in there. You're starting to get a view that most never get of cellars, though. But keep going. Another project. There are not many of you who've ever seen the bell. There's a better shot of the bell. Look at that thing. Easy with heights. You might want to take your Dramamine now because we're getting to the top. It is so much more impressive when you're up top here. Firehouse.
the park. Down past those parked cars is the scout cabin. The top are the Christian Education Edition wing. There's Preston again.
So many of you.
Preston Ziegenfuss Productions. So now I will invite you all to eat. Let us eat.